He's like famous, he dances good. And when he was a little boy, he was singing so cool.
I grew up with his music, and I think he's extremely talented.
This kid does a little bit of everything. He's just so different, so unique in his style.
His thing is music, okay? He's just himself, you know?
People would die for him. Like, you see all those pictures of people all crying and trampling over each other just to get a glimpse of him.
I think he's the ultimate live performer.
I don't know how anybody can dance like that.
He's a great singer. I love him.
He's a genius.
He's the king of pop.
The man is just tremendous. And I'm in my 70s and I love him. So you can imagine what my teenagers do.
He's always been the greatest in my book.
I think he's, you know, a gift to people who love music.
I just wish that he would just kind of take down his walls and just kind of show the world who he really is.
Good evening. I'm Oprah Winfrey, bringing you a world-exclusive interview with the most elusive superstar in the history of music, Michael Jackson. I'm here in front of his California home. It's a ranch on the outskirts of Santa Barbara, where just inside is the man who has broken every possible musical record, denied interviews, and defied definition for years. For nearly a quarter of a century, he has been an innovator of music, of dance, of videos, even fashion. And nothing he does is anything short of spectacular. Tonight, Michael Jackson will continue to surprise us with a rare personal tour of his astounding home, which includes a private movie theater and full-scale amusement park. You're also going to see a special performance by him and the world premiere of his latest music video. Tonight, his silence is broken. Michael Jackson's home is nothing like anyone would expect. I thought there were going to be a few llamas roaming around the living room and maybe some chimps jumping around. Don't get me wrong, I was dead wrong. There are plenty of mind-boggling areas on this 2,700-acre ranch, which you'll see during the next 90 minutes. But where Michael Jackson eats and where he sleeps and where he lives is quite simply a beautiful home. There is a library here filled with leather-bound classics and artwork on the walls. Not at all what we thought we'd find. Before we meet the man who does live here, it's important to know where he came from, for his history is nothing short of incredible. Michael Jackson is the seventh of nine brothers and sisters born in Gary, Indiana, to steel mill worker Joseph and mother Catherine. Some say the Jacksons turned to music the day their television broke down, but from the day they started performing, they were destined for stardom, beginning at a place called Motown. This videotape of the Jacksons' Motown audition shows James Brown's influence on young Michael, and the boys' performance that day brought almost the entire company in to watch. Motown head Berry Gordy knew right away.
Boys, I want to sign you up.
Yeah?
Yeah.
It was the start of a career that broke almost every record in the book, beginning with a string of four consecutive number one hits.
Ghosts and youngsters are amazing. And the little fella in front is incredible.
For the Jackson family, their lives changed almost overnight. They went from obscurity to superstardom, filled with concert tours, limousines, and TV appearances. But it was little Michael who was getting the most attention.
You and I must make a pact. We must bring salvation back. Where there is love, I'll be there.
As the number one hits continued to accumulate, Michael became a star in his own right, releasing song after song, each one turning to gold.
Then most people would turn you away. I don't listen to a word they say.
As the years rolled by, the Jacksons' success continued while their music changed with the changing times. But as the boys grew older, who could have guessed what lay in store for Michael Jackson?
What's going to happen when your voice changes?
Just change.
You're going to be able to stay singing?
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Jackson. Yeah. Your old house. Hey. Hey. Well, how nervous are you right now?
How what?
How nervous are you right now?
I'm not nervous at all, actually.
You really aren't?
No, I never get nervous.
You don't?
No.
No, not even for your first interview and it's live around the world? I thought you'd be a little nervous, but that's great, because if you're not nervous, I won't be nervous. I just wanted to let the world know that when we agreed to do this interview, you said that you would be willing to talk to me about everything, and we haven't discussed one single question that's going to be asked here tonight. Just wanted to make that
right. That's very true.
Very true. When we were watching, I was watching you in the background there, watching the video of you in the early years. Did that bring back memories for you?
It made me giggle.
Yeah.
Because I haven't seen that footage in a long time.
Yeah.
And it bring back memories, yes, me and my brothers, who I love dearly.
Yeah.
And it's just a wonderful moment for me.
Yeah. I saw you laugh when you saw yourself singing Baby, Baby, Baby.
Yeah, because yeah. James Brown, I think James Brown is a genius, you know, when he's with the Famous Flames, which is unbelievable. And I used to watch him on television, and I used to get angry at the cameraman, because whenever he would really start to dance, they would be on a close-up, and I couldn't see his feet. Uh-huh. So I would throw things, I'd be angry. I said, show him, so I could watch and learn.
So he was a big mentor for you,
phenomenal, yeah. Phenomenal.
Yeah, and who else was?
Jackie Wilson, who I adore as an entertainer. And of course, music, Motown,
yeah.
The Bee Gees, who are brilliant. Mm-hmm. I just love great music.
So when I look at those tapes of you, and heaven knows that putting this together, I think I've seen every piece of video ever done of you. And watching those tapes, when, especially in the younger years, you seem to really come alive on stage. There's something going on with you when you were a little boy on stage. Were you as happy off stage as you appeared to be on stage?
Well, on stage for me was home. Mm-hmm. I was most comfortable, and still most comfortable, on stage. But once I got off stage, I was like very sad.
Really?
Yes.
And sad from the beginning? Sad since it first started? Since
lonely,
the
fame? Sad, having to face with popularity and all of that. There were times when I had great times with my brothers, pillow fights and things, but I used to always cry from loneliness.
You did?
Yes.
Beginning at what age?
Oh, very little. 8, 9.
When you all first became famous?
Yes.
So it wasn't what it appeared to be to the rest of the world, all of us. I remember I was a little black child wanting to marry Jackie Jackson, your brother. So, I mean, to all of us, we thought this was the most wonderful thing in the world. Who wouldn't have wanted that life?
It is wonderful, and there is a lot of wonderment in being famous. I mean, you travel the world, and you see things, you meet people, you go places. It's great, but then there's the other side. There's, which I'm not complaining, there's lots of rehearsal, and you have to put a lot of your time, give of yourself a lot.
Do you feel, I talked to Suzanne DePass the other day, and Suzanne DePass worked with you all for a long time at Motown and really groomed you all and found the outfits for the Ed Sullivan show. And Suzanne had some interesting theories about your childhood. We talked about whether or not it was really lost. Was it?
Well, especially now, I come to realize, and then, I would do my schooling, which was 3 hours with a tutor, then right after that, you know, I'd go to the recording studio and record, and I'd record for hours and hours till it was time to go to sleep. So it'd be nighttime, and I remember going to the recording studio. There was a park across the street, and I'd see all the children playing, and they'd be rooting and making noise, and I would cry. It'd make me sad that I would have to go and work instead.
I wanted to go to this to hear what Suzanne had to say about your childhood.
Sure.
And we're going to look at some pictures of you as a little boy.
Okay.
Describe a performance. Describe the performance that you put on.
What I do?
Yeah.
Well, most of my songs are fast.
I mean, what do you put into it?
Well, whatever I sing, that's what I really mean. Like, I'm singing a song. I don't sing it if I don't mean it.
I met Michael Jackson. He was 9 years old, going on 10. And he was a little boy in many ways. And then he'd go out on stage and be this dynamic superstar.
With a child's heart, go face the worries of the day.
He lost the ability to be a kid before his 12th birthday. Michael Jackson really was never able to go anywhere without a bodyguard or without a limousine or without, you know, people to protect him from his success.
No need to worry.
To not ever be able to just go out to the park and look up at the sky and to not be able to go to the movies, I just think that he has paid a tremendous price.
Said it was a heavy price. I want to know how big of a price it was, losing your childhood or having this kind of life.
Well, you don't get to do things that other children get to do. You know, the simple things that they so much take for granted.
Mm-hmm.
Having friends and slumber parties and buddies and just hanging out. There was none of that for me. I didn't have any friends when I was little. My brothers were my friends.
Was there ever a place where, because, you know, children, you know, I remember playing games and talking to myself and playing with my dolls and all that. Was there, and I think every child needs a place to escape into a child's world, into a child's imagination. Was there ever a time you could do that?
No, and that is why I think now, because I didn't have it then, I compensate for that.
Really?
I mean, people wonder why I always have children around, because I find the thing that I never had through them, you know, Disneyland, amusement parks, arcade games. I adore all that stuff because when I was little, it was always work, 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 from one concert to the next. If it wasn't concert, it was the recording studio. If it wasn't that, it was TV shows or interviews or picture sessions.
Mm-hmm.
It was always something to do.
Did you feel, Smokey Robinson has said this about you, and so have many other people, that you were like an old soul in a little body?
When I was, I remember hearing that all the time when I was little. They used to call me a 45-year-old midget wherever I went.
Mm-hmm.
I used to always hear that, and I just would hear it, and I never thought about it. Just like when some people say, when you were little, when you started to sing, did you know you were that good? I said, I never thought about it. I just did it, and it came out. I never thought about it, really.
So here you were, Michael Jackson, with hits. You all had so many hits, 4 hits in a row, and you were crying because you couldn't be like other kids.
Well, I love show business, mm-hmm. and I still love show business, but then there are times you want to play and have some fun, and that part did make me sad. I remember one time we were getting ready to go to South America, and everybody was packed up in the cars, ready to leave and go, and the plane was about to, and I hid, and I was crying while I was hiding, because I really did not want to go. I wanted to play. I did not want to go.
Were your brothers jealous of you when you started getting all the attention?
Not that I know of, mm-hmm. No.
You never felt a sense of jealousy?
Let me think, no.
No?
No, I think they were always happy for me that I could do certain things, you know, and but I've never felt jealousy among them, no.
Do you feel that they're jealous of you now?
I wouldn't think so. I don't think so, no.
No? What's your relationship like with your family? Are you all close still?
I love my family very much. I wish I could see them a little more often than I do. But we understand because we're show business family and we all work. Mm-hmm. We do have family day when we all get together. We'll pick a person's house. It might be Jermaine's house or Marlon's house or Tito's house. And everybody will come together and we'll fellowship and love each other and talk and catch up on who's doing what and, you know.
You all aren't all upset about LaToya and LaToya's book and the things that LaToya has said about the family?
Well, I haven't read LaToya's book. Uh-huh. I just know I love my sister dearly. I love LaToya, and I always will. And I always see her as the happy, loving LaToya that I remember mm-hmm. growing up with. So I couldn't completely answer on that. Mm-hmm.
Do you feel that some of the things that she's been saying are true?
I couldn't answer, Oprah. Honestly, mm-hmm. I haven't read the book. That's the honest truth.
Mm-hmm. So let's go back to when you were growing up and feeling all of this. Well, I guess it's a sense of anguish, I guess. So there was nobody for you to play with other than your brothers. You never had slumber parties. You never?
Never.
Never?
No.
So I'm wondering, for you, being this cute little boy that everybody adored and everybody who comes up to you, they're, you know, pulling your cheeks and how cute, and this child prodigy, really, how adolescence affected you? Because I call, you know, adolescence going through that duck stage where everything's awkward, you know? Yeah. And I'm wondering if when you started to go through adolescence, having been, you know, this child superstar,
yes.
Did that have was that a particularly difficult time for you?
Very, very, very difficult.
Really?
Yes.
Yes.
Because I think every child star suffers through this period because you're not the cute and charming child that you were, and you start to grow. And they want to keep you young forever and little forever.
Who's they?
The public.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, nature takes its course.
Mm-hmm.
And
it does.
And I had pimples so badly, and it made me so shy. I used to not look at myself. I'd wash my face in the dark. I wouldn't want to look in the mirror.
Really?
And my father teased me. And I just hated it. I cried every day because of it.
Your father would tease you about your pimples?
Yes, he would tell me I'm ugly.
Your father would say
yes,
that.
He would. Sorry, Joseph.
Yeah. What's your relationship like with him?
I love my father, but I don't know him.
Mm-hmm. Are you angry with him for doing that? I think that's pretty cruel, actually.
Am I angry with him?
Because adolescence is hard enough without a parent
difficult.
Telling you that you're ugly.
Yeah, it's very difficult.
Uh-huh.
Am I angry with him? Sometime I do get angry, yes. I don't know him the way I'd like to know him. My mother's wonderful. To me, she's perfection. I just wish I could understand my father.
And so let's talk about these teen years. What is that when you started to go inside yourself? Because obviously you haven't spoken to the world for, you know, 14 years, I think, is your last televised interview. So you went inside. You became a recluse, and that was on purpose. Was it to protect yourself?
I felt that there wasn't anything important for me to say. And those were very sad, sad years for me. And
why so sad? Because on stage we see you performing, you're getting your Grammys. Why so sad?
Oh, there's a lot of sadness about my past life and, you know, adolescence and my father and all of those things. It just made me very, very, very sad.
So he would tease you, make fun of you?
Yes.
Did he ever beat you?
Yes.
He did.
Yes.
And that was difficult to take, getting beaten and going on stage and performing.
Yes.
And why would he beat you?
Because he saw me, he wanted me to, I guess maybe, I don't know if I was his golden child or whatever it was. Some may call it a strict disciplinarian or whatever, but he was very strict, very hard. you know, very stern. Mm-hmm. And just a look would scare you, you know, and...
Were you scared of him?
Very frightened. There's been times when he'd come to see me and I would get sick.
Really?
I'd start to regurgitate.
As a child or as an adult?
Both.
Both.
He's never heard me say this. I'm sorry, please don't be mad at me.
Well, I mean, I suppose that everybody has to take responsibility for what they've done in life. And your father is one of those people who also has to take responsibility.
But I do love him.
Yes, I understand.
And I am forgiving.
Yes.
You know, I don't go around
with the chip. But can you really forgive? I say this on my show all the time. Can you really forgive if you haven't gotten angry? If you haven't dealt with how you really feel? I don't know if you can go from having been abused to forgiveness.
I do forgive. There's so much garbage and so much trash that's written about me. Mm-hmm. That is so untrue. Mm-hmm. They're complete lies. And those are some of the things I want to talk about. The press has made up so much god-awful, horrifying stories.
I know.
That are completely appalling.
I know.
Completely appalling. And so far from the truth. And it's made me to realize the more often a person tell a lie, the more times you hear a lie, I mean, you begin to believe it. Mm-hmm. If it's told often enough, you start to believe it. And it's appalling the things that have been said about me, and they're completely false.
There are so many. I normally don't write questions down, but there's so many I didn't want to forget them. First of all, I have been in this house getting lit and getting prepared for this, and I've been all over the house upstairs when you weren't looking for that oxygen chamber. I cannot find the oxygen chamber anywhere in the house.
That story is so crazy. I mean, it's one of those tabloid things. It was completely made up.
Okay, but you are in something there. There's a picture of you. Well, where did that come from? How did it get started?
I did a commercial for mm-hmm. Pepsi, mm-hmm. and I was burned very badly. Mm-hmm. And we settled for like $1 million. And mm-hmm. I gave all the money. We built this place called the Michael Jackson Burn Center. Uh-huh. And that's a piece of technology that's used for burn victims, right?
That.
So I'm looking at the piece of technology. I'm touching it, feeling it, and decide to just go inside of it just to hammer around. Somebody takes a picture. When they process the picture, the person who processes the picture say, oh, Michael Jackson, he made a copy. These pictures went all over the world with this lie attached to it. Hmm. It's a complete lie. Why do people buy these papers and it's not the truth? And I'm here to say, you know, do not judge a person. Do not pass judgment on anyone unless you have talked to them one-on-one. I don't care what the story is. Hmm. Do not judge them because it's a lie.
But that story, you're right, that story, it was like it had legs.
It's crazy.
It is.
Why would I want to sleep in a chamber?
Well, the rumor was that you were sleeping in the chamber because you didn't want to grow old and that
that's
was going to...
It's stupid. It's completely made up, and I'm embarrassed. I'm willing to forgive the press and forgive anybody. You know, I was taught to love and mm-hmm. to forgive, which I do have in my heart. But please, don't believe these crazy,
horrifying
things.
Okay, let's go down the list. Did you buy the elephant man's bones?
No,
were you trying to get them?
That's another stupid story.
Uh-huh.
I love the story of the elephant man. It reminds me of me a lot. You uh-huh. know, I could relate to it. It made me cry because I saw myself in the story. But no, I never asked for the elephant man. Where am I going to put some bones?
I don't know.
Why would I want a pair of bones?
I don't know. So where did that come from?
Someone makes it up and everybody believes it. Mm-hmm. If you hear a lie often enough, you start to believe it.
Yes, and people make money selling tabloids. Yeah. All right. Just recently there was a story, and I know one of your attorneys held a news conference. There was a story about you wanting to have a little white boy play you in a Pepsi commercial.
That is so stupid. That's the most ridiculous, horrifying story I've ever heard. It's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, why? Number one, it's my face as a child mm-hmm. in the commercial. Mm-hmm. Me, when I was little.
Mm-hmm.
Why would I want a white child to play me? I'm a black American. I'm proud to be a black American. I am proud of my race. I am proud of who I am. I have a lot of pride in who I am and dignity. That's like you wanting an Oriental person to play you as a child. Does that make sense?
No.
So please, people, stop believing these horrifying
then
stories.
Then let's go to the thing that is most discussed about you, I think, is the fact that the color of your skin is obviously different than it was when you were younger.
Yes.
And so I think it has caused a great deal of speculation and controversy as to what you have done or are doing. Are you bleaching your skin? And is your skin lighter because you don't like being black?
Okay, number one, there, as I know of, there is no such thing as skin bleaching. Mm-hmm. I have never seen it. I don't know what it is.
Well, they used to have those products growing up. I used to hear, always use bleach and glow, but you'd have to have about 300,000 gallons.
Okay, number one, this is the situation. Yes. I have a skin disorder that destroys the pigmentation of the skin. It's something that I cannot help, okay? But when people make up stories that I don't want to be who I am, it hurts me.
So it is?
It's a problem for me, okay? I can't control it, okay? But what about all the millions of people? Let's reverse it.
Okay.
What about all the millions of people who sit out in the sun to become darker, to become other than what they are? Mm-hmm. Nobody says nothing about that.
So when did this start? When did the color of your skin start to change?
Oh, boy, sometime after Thriller, around Off the Wall Thriller, sometime around
And what did you
there.
Think? I mean, you...
It's in my family. My father said it's on his side. I can't control it. I don't understand. I mean, it makes me very sad. I don't want to go into my medical history because that's something that's private, but that's the situation here. So please, when people see
I just want to get this straight. Yeah. You are not taking anything to change the color of your skin?
Oh, God, no.
You did not purposely?
We're trying to control it, and using makeup evens it out because it makes blotches on the skin, and I have to even out my skin. Uh-huh. But you know what's funny? Why is that so important? Mm-hmm. You know, that's not important to me. I'm a great fan of art. I love Michelangelo. Mm-hmm. If I had a chance to talk to him or read about him, I would want to know about what inspired him to become who he is, the anatomy of his craftsmanship, not about who he went out with last night or why he decided to sit out in the sun so long. What's wrong with, I mean, that's what's important to me.
How much plastic surgery have you had?
Very, very little. Mm-hmm. Very, you can count them on two fingers. I mean, let's say this, if you want to know about those things, all of the nosy people in the world,
once we say it, we don't have to say it anymore.
Read my book, Moonwalker, it's in my book. You know, let's just put it this way, if all the people in Hollywood who have had plastic surgery, if they went on vacation, there wouldn't be a person left in town.
I think you might be right.
I think I am right. I mean, the empty.
So did you start having plastic surgery because of those teen years, because of not liking the way you look?
No, not really.
Not really?
No, it's only two things. Read it, get my book. It's no big deal.
Okay. You don't want to tell me what it is? You had your nose done, obviously.
Yeah, but so did a lot of people that I know.
Yeah. And so when you hear all these things about you, and there have been more than we
but
are
I've
even
I've never had my cheekbones done, never had my eyes done, never had all that my lips done and all this stuff. They just go too far. I mean, it's crazy. But this is something that happens like every day with other people.
Are you pleased now with the way you look?
I'm never pleased with anything. I'm a perfectionist.
Yeah.
It's part of who I am.
And so when you look in the mirror now and the image that looks back at you, are there days when you say, well, I kind of like this, or I like
no,
the hair today?
I'm never
pleased. I think
pleased
I'm pretty
with
cute
myself.
Today.
I'm pretty cute today. No, I try not to look in the mirror. I really do, because I'm never happy with what I see. So I go on with my work and get it done.
I have to ask you this. So many mothers in my audience have said to please ask you this question.
Yeah.
Why do you always grab your crotch?
Why do I grab my crotch?
Yeah, why? We think you got a thing with your crotch going on here.
I think it happens subliminally. When I dance, if you're a dancer, you know, you're just interpreting the sounds and the accompaniment of the music. If there's a driving bass, you become the bass. If there's a cello, if there's a string, you become that. So you become the emotion of what that sound is. Okay? So if I'm doing a movement and I go bam and I grab myself, it's the music that compels me to do it. It's not saying I'm getting ready to grab down there and it's not a great place. You don't think about it, it just happens. Sometime I'll look back at the footage and I'll go, did I do that?
Yeah.
So I'm slave to the rhythm.
Yeah.
Okay?
I think the alarm's going off in the house, I don't know why. But we're gonna fix it in a minute, we're in live television, so we're gonna go to break. These things happen, we'll be right back.
Okay.
Are y'all ready for the jam?
Man with the glove, Michael Jackson, was honored with a star today on Hollywood's Walk of Fame.
If Elvis took him into the stores in the 50s and the Beatles did it in the 60s, Michael Jackson is the man of the 80s.
If Michael Jackson has a trophy room, he's going to have it enlarged, because last night he came home with another armload of hardware.
And the winner is Billie Jean Michael Jackson.
Off the wall, Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson.
When you have broken all those records, when you have the number one album ever sold, the number two album ever sold, when you've broken every record there is to break, when you have become an icon in the industry, is there always the pressure to do something bigger and something better?
Oh, gee, that is something. It makes it harder each time to follow up. So you try to be as original as you can be without thinking about statistics. Just do go from the soul and from the heart.
Mm-hmm. And so when you think of that, what do? You go, you meditate, you think, well, I will now do the Super Bowl. I will now.
No. I just create out of my heart, really.
I want to tell everybody, too, since we're back and we're live, we weren't prepared for, and I know this house probably wasn't prepared for all the lights that are here. And what happened was that a smoke alarm went off from all the lights that are around, and that's what happened, and that's why we went to break. So I wanted to also make it clear, because this is another rumor that's starting, that the only way I could have gotten this interview was that I contractually agreed to call you the King of Pop. And I would just like to say to the world, Michael did not tell me to call him the King of Pop. As a matter of fact, I haven't called you the King of Pop once here. And I frankly think that the King of Pop is probably too limiting a title for you. I mean, I think that most of the world would agree that you're no doubt one of the greatest entertainers the world has ever seen. So you would be king of entertainment, or Liz Taylor said you were king of pop, rock, and soul. Where did this whole notion that you proclaimed yourself king of pop come from?
Well, I didn't proclaim myself to be anything. Mm-hmm. I'm happy to be alive. Mm-hmm. I'm happy to be who I am. King of Pop was first said by Elizabeth Taylor on one of the award shows.
As a matter of fact, we have that. Let's roll that.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 1989 Heritage Award and Sammy Davis Jr. Award recipient, and in my estimation, the true king of pop, rock, and soul, Mr. Michael Jackson.
And that's where this all started?
Yes, and then fans, all the stadiums that we play, they bring big banners that say the King of Pop, and jackets that say the King of Pop, and t-shirts that say the King, and they chant it outside my hotel, King of Pop, King of Pop, King. So it just became something that just, you know,
that
happens
just
all over the world.
Happened.
Yeah.
But you didn't tell me to call you King of Pop.
No. Why would I tell you to call me King?
I've been calling you Michael.
Yeah, I think the press loves to just start trouble like that. I mean, again, do not read the tabloids, please. It's crazy.
Do you go out? Do you date?
Yes.
Who do you date?
Well, right now it's Brooke Shields.
Hmm.
We try not to just be everywhere and go. It's mostly at home. She'll come over. I'll go to her house because I don't like going out in the public.
Have you ever been in love?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. With Brooke Shields?
Yes, and another girl.
And another girl. I'm going to ask you this, and it's embarrassing for me to ask you this, but I'm going to ask you anyway. Are you a virgin?
How could you ask me that question?
I just want to know. I want to know.
I'm a gentleman.
You're a gentleman.
I'm a gentleman.
So
I'm a gentleman.
So, okay. I would interpret that to mean that means that you believe that a lady is a lady, and therefore
that's something that's private. I mean, you know, shouldn't be spoken about openly. You can call me old-fashioned if you want, but, you know, to me that's very personal.
So you're not going to answer it?
I'm embarrassed.
So you're not going to answer it. Well, we would like to know whether or not there is a possibility that you are going to marry one day and have children.
I would feel that my life isn't complete if I do not, because I adore the family life. I adore children, and I adore that whole thing. And I would love to. That's one of my dreams, but I couldn't right now because I'm married. I am married, but to my work.
Mm-hmm.
I'm married to my music. And it has to be that closeness in order to do the kind of work that I want to do. And
so what kind of woman makes you, I know in the video, wait a minute, no, in the video we're going to see later, we're premiering the world video, but you say there's a line where you talk about being quenched. So what kind of person does that for you?
Quench my desire.
Yeah, quench my desire.
Yeah. Well, Brooke, I've always liked her.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, when I was little, I used to stay with Diana Ross, me and my brothers. We stayed with her for years. I never said this, I always had a crush on her.
You did?
Yes.
I heard too, this was another one of those rumors, that you had proposed to Elizabeth Taylor at some point.
Elizabeth Taylor is gorgeous, yeah. Beautiful, and she still is today.
Yeah.
And I'm crazy about her.
Yeah, but did you propose to her?
I would like to have.
Yeah. Well, Elizabeth Taylor is here. Liz, can we bring Liz in now? Liz had said that she wanted to be here to hold your hand through this. You don't look like you need your hand held.
Hi, Elizabeth.
Elizabeth Taylor.
Hello, Linda.
Hi. Have a seat.
Nice
have a seat.
Thank you.
Did Michael ever propose to you?
No. And I never proposed to him.
Never did. What do you think is most misunderstood about Michael Jackson, Liz?
All the things you mentioned. He is the least weird man I've ever known.
Mm-hmm.
He is highly intelligent, shrewd, intuitive, understanding, sympathetic, generous to almost a fault of himself.
Uh-huh.
And he just, if he has any eccentricities, it's that he is like larger than life, and some people just can't accept that or face it or understand it. His talent on stage, why I called him the king of pop, rock, soul, music, entertainment, whatever.
Yes.
There's nobody that can come near him.
Yeah.
Nobody can dance like that, write the lyrics like that, the music, cause the kind of excitement that he does.
And why do you think you all are such friends? What has brought this kind of bond? Because people tried to make this be weird.
Well, it's not. I mean, our childhoods are very similar.
Mm-hmm.
And we have that from the very beginning in common. I was a child star at 9, had an abusive father. And that kind of brought us close together in the very beginning.
And what is it, I'm going to ask Michael this question later on, but what is it you most want the world to know about him?
What a wonderful, giving, caring, generous man he is, and how good he is.
And he's funny too.
Oh, he's wildly funny.
He can crack some jokes, I tell you.
Yeah, but yeah. He's a good man.
Thank you for joining us too, because I know
fine.
You didn't want to be on camera at first, but thank you.
Let's see who's bad, man. Come on, let's go.
From Michael's house down to this amazing amusement park, which is about several hundred yards, I guess, from the house. And this is, it's incredible.
Thank you.
And I want to know whether or not you did this for yourself, or did you do it for all the children that you entertain here?
For myself and the children. Every 3 weeks we have terminally ill children,
mm-hmm.
that come
to the house,
yeah.
Make-A-Wish Foundation, Dream,
yeah.
Street,
every 3 weeks,
Starlight, yes.
Yeah.
And these are sick children, children with cancer, and I entertain them.
Uh-huh.
And they come here. This is unbelievable. They enjoy themselves.
And what I have to say is these are not, as I was talking to some kids who were here, these aren't just grandma rides here. These are some major rides. I mean, the Sea Dragon and the Ferris wheel, and there's that zipper over there.
The Wipeout.
Yeah, Wipeout. There are bumper cars here. It's really...
Thank you. Well, it brings out the child that lives inside of everybody. I love rides and things like that, but I share it with
the kids. Able to do it when you were a kid? And
not really. Sometime, but not often enough.
But now you can anytime.
Every
how
day
often do
it's
you
right
actually,
in my backyard.
How often do you actually come out here and do this?
Whenever I'm here, I come out and I go on the ride.
Well, is this a part of you, what we were talking about earlier, the pain of growing up and not being able to experience all the things that kids normally experience, and so now you are fulfilling all of those fantasies?
You compensate, yes.
Really?
Yes, it's very true.
Do you think you can ever really recapture it, though? Does it feel the same? I mean, I don't
it's
know.
It's more fun.
Is
I wouldn't
it really?
Change the past if I had to.
Would not.
I'm enjoying myself.
And here we are inside the theater. I had one too many sugar babies here the other day at the candy counter. But the candy's here for all the kids, and Pinocchio's here, and E.T.'s here. Did you? What's fascinating to me about you is that, obviously, you have this childlike aura about you. And I see children with you, and they play with you like you are one of them. But a child did not do this. A child did not put this together.
Oh, that's sweet.
Yeah. This is really magnificent.
Well, thank you. I love to do things for children, and I try to imitate Jesus. And not I'm not saying I am Jesus. I'm not saying...
Yeah. We're clear on that.
Right. I'm
We're
trying clear. To imitate Jesus in the fact that he said to be like children, mm-hmm. to love children, to be as pure as children are, mm-hmm. and to make yourselves as innocent and see the world through eyes of wonderment and the whole magical quality of it all. And I love that. And we have the children, like we'll have like 100 bald-headed children here who they all have cancer. Mm-hmm. And they're running around and they're enjoying themselves, and it just make me cry happy tears that I was able to do that for them.
Really?
You know, it makes me so pleased inside.
Well, when I came here to about a month ago to shoot commercials with you for promoting tonight's event, one of the things that really impressed me the most, and I hope you guys are getting shot to this. I don't know how you are if all the cameras are on us, but, oh, we got other cameras, is that there are built inside the walls here beds. Beds for some of those sick children who come. And what I realized when I saw that is that you have to be a person who really cares about children to build it into your architecture.
Yes.
Yes.
We have children that come who are intravenously. They're very sick, and they're bedridden, and they
can't sit up.
Right. They can't sit up. And these beds, they're hospital beds. Uh-huh. You push a button, they move up, and they move down, and they're able to watch. We have a magic show. We show the current films, if it's cartoons, anything. Uh-huh. You know, and anything so they can escape to that world of magic that they don't get a chance to experience, the world that I was deprived of.
Now, let me ask you this.
Little.
You know, I believe everything happens in people's lives for a reason. Do you think that had you not missed a lot of the life and fun and fantasy of childhood, that you would be so in touch with children today? Would you relate to them as
I
you did?
I probably would, but not as much. That's why I wouldn't change a thing.
Really?
Because I'm happy with the way things are and my caring for young people and everything.
Are you really happy now? Because you've seemed sad for a long time.
I was sad for years and years and years, but I'm happy. I'm getting there, yes. I'm very happy.
And what's made you happier?
Being able to give back, mm-hmm. you know, and to help people. Heal the World Foundation, which I formed, mm-hmm. which helps children and healing and the world. We're doing Heal LA, which is, we have three goals in mind, the immunization of children, mm-hmm. mentoring a Big Sister, Big Brother program, and education on drug abuse. And Jimmy Carter has teamed up with us to do Heal Atlanta. Uh-huh. And we're going to go from state to state healing. You know, we've done Sarajevo, we've done lots of places.
I know, we have photographs of you from all over the world where you're with all of these children. One of the things I was saying before we went to the last break, before the alarm went off in the house and all of that,
yeah.
is that we were talking about the rumors. One of the strangest ones I heard was that when you're moonwalking, you're faking it, that you have some mirrors in your socks someplace, and
oh,
that it's not really real.
No, that's not true.
How did you, first of all, you know, we've spent so much time trying to dispel the rumors, trying to get the truth out, that I haven't had a really opportunity to talk to you about how you conceive your music, how you conceive the dance. Where did the moonwalk come from, actually?
Well, the moonwalk came from these beautiful children, these black kids who live in the ghettos and, you know, the inner cities, who are brilliant. They just have that natural talent for dancing. Any of the new hot, the Running Man, any of these dances, they come up with these dances. All I did was enhance the dance.
Okay, I want to see you dance. I want to see you dance.
No.
I want to see you dance live.
No, I can show you a step or two, but I'm a little rusty right now.
A little rusty.
Well, that's the moonwalk. Wait, did you catch it from the sideways?
Got to turn sideways?
Are you from the front?
Yeah, we got you.
From the sideways.
You go okay, just show me slow motion. Could you show me slow motion?
Okay. Wait. It's like, it's pushing and... Then there's... It's mainly like a popping type of thing.
Well,
I'm sorry.
I saw it live. And so you took it from the kids who were doing it.
Yeah, because I think they're the real dancers.
Yeah. And when you are, for instance, when we were here before to shoot that commercial, you were preparing for the Super Bowl.
You were supposed to do this with me.
I don't know how to do this. You know I don't know how to do this. You know what? I mean, all the things ever printed in the tabloid, the only thing's ever been true is when they said I couldn't dance. And that, that is the truth. When we were here the last time shooting the commercial, you were like in between shots running off, conceiving the dance, choreographing the dance. You were up all night dancing.
On the Super Bowl?
Yes.
Well... I'm never satisfied, even when I see something that I've done and people say, oh, it was phenomenal when I did Motown 25 and I did the moonwalk for the first time. I was backstage crying afterwards because I was unhappy.
You cried after Motown 25?
After Motown 25. But then as I was walking to the car, there was this little boy, he was like 12, he was a little Jewish kid, and he said, you're amazing. Who taught you to ever dance like that? And for the first time, I felt I did a good job because I know children don't lie, and I just felt so good about it then.
You wanted to, you felt so good, you probably wanted to say, hee-hee. I want you to sing something a cappella for me if you can.
Oh, no. What can I sing?
Who is it? You know, that whole, do that little beat thing. Since we're here in the theater.
Oh, boy. What could I sing? Who is it?
Where did that hee-hee thing come from?
It just comes out of hee-hee. Out of singing. Wait.
Thank you very much for doing it. Thank
you
very
much for doing it.
We're going to come right back with more of Michael Jackson live. That was great. I love that. That was great.
I have something I want to tell you.
Yes, Michael?
I'm not like other guys.
Of course not. That's why I love you.
No, I mean I'm different.
What are you talking about?
Ah!
music videos used to just be people singing their song until you came along and changed music videos. Did you know when you first conceived your first one that's what you were doing?
Yeah, the idea was to make something that was a story, so it had a beginning, a middle, and an ending. And mm-hmm. you could follow, like a mini movie. That's what I wanted to do. And that's what we did with Beat It and Thriller and Smooth Criminal and all those type of things.
So when you start to look at a piece of work or look at a piece of music, are you already thinking about how you're going to...
Sometime, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, that's very true.
I wonder what it feels like. I will never know since I cannot sing one thing. But what it feels like to be on stage with a sea of people. One of the things that has impressed me in putting the pieces together for you is all around the world, the response to you is so incredible. I just wanted to for the rest of you in the world who haven't seen how people respond to Michael Jackson, to take a look. So when you're standing there and there's a sea of people responding to you, screaming your name as they were, what does that feel like?
Love. Mm. You feel lots of love, and I feel blessed and honored to be able to be an instrument of nature that was chosen to give them that. What I give them, I'm very honored and happy about that.
An instrument of nature, that's an interesting way to describe yourself.
Thank you.
Yeah. Are you very spiritual?
In what sense?
I mean, do you meditate? Do you understand that there's something bigger than yourself at work here?
I believe in God, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Very much.
And I believe everybody comes to the world for a reason, I think. Most of us spend our lives trying to figure out what the purpose of our being here is. What do you think yours is?
My purpose? Mm-hmm. Oh, boy. I think... to give in the best way I can through song and through dance and through music. I mean, I am committed to my art. I believe that all art has as its ultimate goal the union between the material and the spiritual, the human and the divine. I believe that to be the reason for the very existence of art. Mm-hmm. And I feel I was chosen as an instrument to just give music and love and harmony to the world. Children of all ages, and adults and teenagers.
Do you think that by talking now, setting the record straight for yourself, that maybe people will be able to focus more attention on your music and not judge you for anything other than the kind of music that you play?
I would hope so. I would love that.
So we want to know how it starts on a piece of paper, Quench My Desire, and turns into that.
Well... Give in to me. I wanted to write another song, you know, that was kind of exciting and fun and had a rock edge to it, you know, when I did Beat It and Black or White. And Slash, who is a dear friend of mine, we love animals and things like that. He wanted to play guitar, and I wanted him to play guitar on it. And we got together, and we went to Germany, and we shot this thing in just like 2 hours, really. We had no time at all to shoot it. We wanted it to be something exciting and fantastical, and fans, and, you know, like it's a our rock concert. Mm. And that's, we end up, that's the result of.
You mentioned animals, and I know everyone's going to ask me when I leave here, where are all the animals? I said in the opening, I expected chimps to be jumping all over the living room, and I didn't see any. Where's Bubbles?
Well, the animals are everywhere. Uh-huh. They're in their habitats. They're all over the ranch. Mm-hmm. And they come out in the daytime, and they play, and they jump around. They have their own playground in their area.
Why were you so fascinated by animals, do you think?
Because I find in animals the same thing that I find so wonderful in children, that purity, that honesty, where they don't judge you, they don't want anything from you, just to be your friend. And I think that's so sweet.
I do too. I think we've cleared up all the rumors, though. There are no chimps running around the house, no oxygen tank in the house. I don't know. Are you going to lay off the crotch a little bit?
Ask the music.
Ask the music, will he lay off the crotch? Oh, we didn't get about the inauguration. Did you tell President Clinton that you had to be the only person there singing?
That is horrible. That is the stupidest, craziest story I have ever heard. Mm-hmm. I mean, why would I just want me? Nobody else could be on the show, just me. I mean, that's so stupid to me. I mean, it's crazy. That's not even in my heart. Mm-hmm. I would never say anything like that. Again, somebody made it up and the whole world believed it. It is so false. It's incredible.
What do you want most? What do you want the world to know about you most? I ask Liz that of you. What do you want them to know?
Like to be remembered for?
Well, not be remembered for. What about known for now? Forget remembered.
Oh, known for now. As to be an artist, a great artist. I love what I do, and I would love people to love what I do. And to be loved, I just simply want to be loved wherever I go, all over the world, because I love people of all races from my heart with true affection.
Mm. You know, Gene Siskel, who's a movie critic, asked me this question once, and I love the question. So I'm going to ask you. You're 34 years old. What do you know for sure?
What do I know for sure?
What do you know for sure?
Oh, boy. I'm still learning. I mean, life is an education for me. I can't say I know anything for sure.
Well,
I really believe that.
I can't thank you enough for letting us in. And I wish you all the happiness in the world. I love being here because it makes me feel like a child again. And one of the things I promised myself was when this interview was over, live around the world, I was going to go get on that Ferris wheel. And that is exactly what I intend to do. I'm going to take off my blue shoes, and I'm going to ride on the Ferris wheel. I'm going to have a good time, have myself a little popcorn maybe. And maybe when it's all over, you'll teach me how to do the moonwalk when everybody's not watching. Maybe that'll be
okay. Yeah. That sounds good.
Yeah. This was fun.
Yeah, lots of fun.